and welcome to this week's look at action and stunts on film and television. How are you? You look very well. Thank you for coming back and joining me once again. If you've listened to the podcast this week, you will know that we are talking about Action Jackson from 1988, the vehicle that was really to create Carl Weathers as the new action hero. You know, he'd done, he'd been very familiar in the Rocky pictures and, of course, in Predator. And then it didn't really happen, which was a great shame because there's some terrific action sequences in this. Stunt coordinator is the legendary Geoffrey Brown, and the movie is directed by Craig Baxley. Craig Baxley from the A-Team. If you compare the action on this and on Predator, for instance, because he was second unit director and stunt coordinator on that, you'll see there's a huge amount of similarities here, and he works to that whole thing that if it ain't broke, don't change it. You know, those wonderful slow-mo moments that are captured beautifully in this, and it's just a joy. There's a number of great moments, the taxi chase particularly, which we will take a look at. I've always enjoyed it. It's never really been associated as being one of those pictures, you know, ones that really hit that benchmark. It missed the box office returns, most certainly, although it was popular. It did reasonably well, but it certainly didn't do enough to warrant the second picture, which was already in the early stages of development by the end of the filming of this one. And then it just didn't do the business it was supposed to do elsewhere, i.e. video sales, presumably. Sadly, Carl didn't get that type of response that he was looking for, and unfortunately, you know, didn't get to is making a bit of a resurgence now, what with The Mandalorian work of that nature. But Happy Gilmore, of course, is another great example of him at work in a slightly different situation. But Action Jackson is well worth a delve into, and let's do that now. Action Jackson from 1988. At the start of the movie, there is this extraordinary moment. This particular young lady gets punched and thrown through there. That stunt woman, Diane Peterson, going through there. And then there's this remarkable moment where this guy is shot and blown out of a building. Now, there's a couple of moments. That's a real stunt performer. I'm not sure who at the moment, so there's no names on that. That's a dummy. That's a second part of the fall. Then it cuts away to another performer falling through the roof, possibly wired to a point, and landing there. It's absolutely remarkable. More on that when the information lands. Branscombe Richmond, on the other hand, a performer who does make an appearance during the picture. You'll remember him from License to Kill there, look, getting attacked by Bond in the Barrelhead Bar. He's done a lot. Renegades was a big TV show. You may remember that. He was a sidekick in that. He's in the motel room fight as a double. And there's our hero fighting. There's Richmond doing the doubling. Goes out through the window and lands on the ledge opposite. Look at that. That's fairly impressive. Now the two, Jackson and the girl, have to escape from the police, who go, "We're coming up." And then he and they jump out of the window, landing in the car below. Nice fall. Julius LaFleur is the major double here, and Simone Boisserie is doubling the girl. It's a nice jump. And then they reverse it from the other angle. Look, dropping down, and you can see a bit of padding underneath that, some cardboard boxes and bits and pieces underneath so they can do that. The taxi chase is the key moment in the movie for me. That's Sharon Stone. Carl and Sharon walk out, just about to have a conversation, and down comes a taxi and he jumps across the bonnet of the car. Paula Moody, doubling Sharon, driving the taxi, is Bob Miner. Bob Miner's a big name. Been in many, many movies as a coordinator, as a performer. He was coordinator on Magnum for many, many years. He was also in Commando. He has an appearance in that. He plays one of the soldiers looking after Matrix House. There he is. Coffee, a movie that he did with Pam Grier back in the 70s, 73, I think. There's the two of them together. And many other appearances, one of which on Deep Space Nine as a Klingon. And there he is. Lots of creature work he's done as well. So he's driving the taxi. Carl Weathers shifting like a sprinter here, really giving it the beans, running down, trying to catch the taxi. Now, with a lot of these movies, as you can appreciate, the cars sometimes, if they're doing actor car things, they're not moving terribly quickly. And they're probably going to do a similar sort of thing here. But for the purpose of the edit, the editor's made it work and given it the impression that he's keeping up with him the whole way. But his major goal is to get at and on top of that car, which he does here by jumping from this vehicle and landing. Look at the height. He's got plenty of height there. He'll be landing separately into boxes below. And then they cut to the rooftop. Now, this is probably a fixed camera position. There's some shots here. That's obviously Julius LaFleur on the roof, doubling Carl Weathers. A couple of moments along the way where he's getting out of the way, people getting out of the way. It's all ND driving. Lots of this. This is all Baxley stuff. This is typical stuff from Baxley's era. There's Joel Kramer going across the street as an ND. Boom, there's accidents left, right and centre. There's a big explosion coming up as well. I've slowed this section down because I love the way that this car slides into shot with a fixed camera position. They're just panning across and there's the slide on top of the roof and it's trying to hang on. It's magnificent. There's going to be a big... This wagon here, bang, there's the impact and there's the explosion. That's a big bang. That is a big bang. Majorly impressive that, again, with every Julius hanging onto the roof and that car being thrown about by Bob in traffic. Now he starts firing through the roof. I'm not so sure about this bit, but anyway, it's one way to get off the bonnet of the car, and now he's decided he's had enough. He slams the windscreen, turns the wheel, and the vehicle slides again, hits the brakes, and off he goes. That's Julius. Probably the only time you'll get to see him up close. But now there's a standoff. Look at the building in the distance. This is where it's going to end. And they decide, Bob Miner decides, right, I can take you without having to shoot you. He floors the accelerator, gives it the beans, and now Julius jumps up into the air using an air ram. That's going to fire him up into the air. They're just off center. He's not actually jumping over the car. He's jumping near the car. And he gets right over the top. And then the edit has him flipping through the air and Weathers landing in that superhero pose. Car pulls out. Henry Kinji's now driving the car because obviously Bob's in an acting role here. Up the pipe ramp. You see the front of the car bend as it hits the top of the pipe and then flips to the left and is about to bury itself in the side of this building. It's enormously impressive. I've slowed it down here. It's slowed down in the picture to a point. It's not slowed down this much, but it just gives you an idea of how... Look at the distance he's travelling as well. It really is... I mean, at this point, as soon as you leave the pipe ramp, you're a passenger. Henry's done enough of these. Henry Kinji is responsible for many, many fabulous pipe ramps in the A-Team, of course, which Baxley was stunt coordinator and second unit director on. Lots of those Jeeps in the opening sequence and some of those early episodes flipping through the air and landing and the guys climbing out. Henry Kinji was responsible for many, many of those. And the car then, boom. That's fantastic. It really is I think it's a standout moment. I really do. Well worth the ticket price. There's other fire gags, none as impressive as the first one, but this is quite an interesting one. This is Doug Coleman, and he's playing a character here who's taking a beating, gets electrocuted, and bang, goes up in smoke. It goes from being look, just to a partial burn, to this, which is a different burn. I'm not quite certain of who this is, but I tell you what, that's a massive explosion. And that's a full body burn. He will have a number of layers on there with some cooling gel to prevent that heat getting through. But it's all timed. And the moment that he gets down on the ground and lays himself flat, that's the moment that the safety team come in to put him out. But it's massively impressive, and those flames are, ooh, what, 10, 11 feet above. He's flipping over, right over, look, his legs coming right over the top of his head. And that's a great deal of heat. And I think that's very impressive, and certainly another standout moment in the picture, the way in which the fire looks really impressive on screen. Done very well there. Now, the end fight. I got a couple of issues with the end fight. Firstly, there's a couple of moments where the punch and the kick looks good, right? It's from a distance. And this one here, Gary Baxley doubling your man here. And when you've got the stuntman doing it, yep, they've got the timing right. They've got everything right. This one, look, he's not sold that punch at all. The important part is selling it. That looks like a hit from this angle. That's the stuntman. He's not fighting with the actor there. This one, this is a miss. Look, where was that going? On the top of his head, and he's reacted the other way. This is also a huge miss. Look at this. Where's that leg going? I have no idea where that leg going, but he's reacted to it, and he's thrown himself over onto the bonnet of the car in the room, incidentally, because he drove into it. But there was no way in hell that made any contact whatsoever. But he's managed to sell his death scene here, throwing that against the wall, and that's powerful stuff. And if you're going to go, you go expensive. Poor old Craig T. Nelson, what a way to go. Probably his finest moment in the movie. There you go. It's action-packed. It's got some great stuff. Love the slow-mo stuff. The pipe roll is fabulous. And it's also very interesting to note that, of course, Bob Miner, fabulous stuntman for many years, coordinator on Magnum, got some great action going on there. And, of course, in this particular role, is the character. He's the cab driver. But he's on acting duty. So they can't risk, unless they scheduled it at the end of his filming, which I suspect it probably wasn't. And therefore, on the strength of that, he has to be doubled. Geoffrey Brown, the stunt coordinator. You'll remember him, of course, from Speed and that wonderful bus jump. So he's in charge of the action. And he said, no, I'm going to get somebody in. And gets Henry Kinji in. I mean, of all the people to get in, what a legend. Henry himself is responsible for some extraordinary pipe roles in the A-Team. You remember those big Jeep jumps flipping through the air? A couple of those featured in the title sequence of the A-Team. That's Henry. And nailing this one as well. It's always fabulous. It crashes into that building. It's a wonderful, wonderful sequence, and it's a beautiful role. Perfectly executed. Carl's got some speed on him, hasn't he? I've said this before. I said it in the podcast as well. But Jesus, he can move. Like a rat of an aqueduct, boom, firing along, keeping up with the vehicle, and then making that lovely transition from him to Julius LaFleur, who, of course, is the stunt double, and doing some wonderful work there. Tony Brubaker, legend has it that Tony Brubaker was doubling Carl throughout the picture. And I spoke to Tony not too long ago when I was doing some research for this, and he said, I didn't double him. You know, I did a couple of days here. He remembers being involved in that taxi chase. He said, I drove a car. I was an ND stuntman. But I wasn't involved in the doubling of the actor. That was always Julius. And it's funny how these things come around. Somebody gets a message. Somebody says, oh, yes. And then the next thing you know, it becomes fact. And in fact, there were certain statements from on set, people who were on set at the time, who said, yep, I remember Tony doubling Carl. Yeah, absolutely. Of course, it never happened. So huge thanks to Tony for clearing that up, and his wife Sharon for being so lovely when I rang them. But there we are. Action Jackson, a belter. Enjoyed that. Next week, changing tact completely, we're going to the West, and we're going in a big-scale Oscar-winning picture, directed by, well, predominantly by Kevin Costner and Kevin Reynolds, and it is Dances with Wolves from 1991, a beautiful movie, lots of terrific action that we want to have a look at there, and we will explore that next week. If you fancy subscribing, go on, hit the button, the little things on the screen there, hit that, you'll get all the notifications that you need. Don't forget to check out the Pod Dojo Network. They're the people who are responsible for the podcast. They have some great podcasts on there as well, so you get a chance to explore their back catalogue. And that's about the size of it, really. Don't forget to catch up on the socials. There's a link at the bottom there. Click the link. The link in. LinkedIn? No, not LinkedIn. Linktree. I knew I'd get that wrong. Linktree, that's the one. Click that. There's all the links. Go and explore what else is available from Behind the Stunts elsewhere. And we will see you all again next week for more of the same. Until then, it's bye for now.